Well, welcome to the 2021 LV4 airframe capstone handoff. It's going to take about 8 hours. And so relax. And please ask questions. Please interrupt. Please tell us we're doing this wrong and suggest things to go over, all that kind of stuff. I have a loose agenda, but not a very strong one. So we'll go back and forth. Very much encouraging people to ask questions and make sure that everything is clear as we hand off. So let's start off with the overview of the project. Caps owners, could you open up the project proposal that we gave you at the beginning?
This one?
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so if you go down, we said extract performance requirements from the MDO and do a detailed design of the LV4 airframe and do an analysis of the design and test and build a composite module and an isogrid module. And of course, we didn't do any of that, but we do have an isogrid module. It's not tested, but it is designed and built. We said we'd pay up to $2,000, but you guys got a UTEEP, Oregon Space Grant Consortium Undergraduate Team Experience Award Program, which was amazing. And we used that money to get the isogrid. We gave you SolidWorks or Onshape, and you chose Onshape. Thank you for that. I don't think that's all. I think that's all we need to say about that. Deliverables, at the very bottom, completed CAD model, completed FEA, bill of materials, and then integration of the airframe into the MDO.
We do not have a bill of materials because it's still vaporware.
That's acceptable. We won't fail you this time around. Maybe. I think that's fine. I think the most important thing for bill of materials is the number of screws on LV4, the number of fasteners. How many fasteners are on that thing?
1,100.
Sorry, that's just insane. We need each of them on their own line in a bill of materials by tomorrow morning, 8 a.m.
We do have a fastener spreadsheet. I don't think it's up to date with quantities, but we do have one.
Oh, that's great. Actually, yes. Good. And at the moment, it says, so let's go over the status of this. We have a complete CAD model. There are parts that are missing, but in overall, it's complete, correct?
Yeah.
You've not done FEA on all the components. Which components have you run FEA on?
FEA was run on ISO tanks, end caps, launch lug brackets, and somewhat of the full launch lug assembly, which is a little confusing, but basically like where it attaches to the coupling ring. And then end caps, I don't know if I said that, and fins. And I think he did individual models, but he did not do a full noodle rocket analysis.
Okay, and then finally, what's the sort of the 10,000 foot view on integration to the MDO?
What do you mean?
So what's the current status of the design that you have versus the most recent MDO run that Corey did?
So it depends on if you are like Corey and consider the most recent one canonical or not, but basically the one that said that we wanted 100 kilometers. We met, I think we were lower than the mass budget, Jim can correct me on that, and pretty much right on height target. But I think with the added weight from propulsion, we didn't reach 100 kilometers, which is why we changed it to 50. But I think from our standpoint, we met everything.
Great. Okay, yeah, I don't expect a tight spiral right at the very end, but that's fine. So he had 2.2 meter tanks in the very last run. You guys didn't update it to match that, did you?
No.
Okay, that's perfectly fine. Good. All right. Well, that's a good overview. Let's dive right into your most important deliverable, which would be the final report. Okay. Great. Okay, so let's just go over it from a 100-kilometer point of view. Keep going down. Okay, you've got client market requirements. Oh, that's adorable. I love that picture. We're going to steal that picture. Absolutely. All right, keep going. This is great. Good. Okay, and stop here for just a minute. Okay, so at this point, it would be nice to just give everybody a quick overview of the different parts of LV4. Do you want to do that in CAD or do you want to do that here?
I think I'll start with this picture and then we'll switch over to CAD because this picture is really good for describing it.
It is. Would you don't mind changing your view to 150% and getting rid of the left-hand column?
Yeah, sure, I guess. Okay.
Thank you.
And then Jim, and I know Billy's internet is bad, but if you two ever want to hop in, feel free to interrupt me. But so the top picture is the front view and the bottom picture is a section view. So number one is the nose cone. Number two is ERS, which is the electromechanical recovery system. And then three A, B, and C are pass-through modules, and they were changed. Originally, there was a separate camera module, and then the pass-through modules were different, and we basically merged them all, and the RCS module as well, which is reaction control system, and so we can make just one pass-through design and then machine it however many times we need to, which in this case we have 7, and then the window covers will be used to modify it for if it needs to hold cameras or race pipes or nozzles, anything like that. So they're all the same. 3A is the RCS, 3B holds the cameras, and then 3C are just general pass-throughs. So their window covers are mostly blank except for the ones where the race pipes go inside. And the race pipes, which you can't really see here, but you'll see them in CAD, help to carry nitrogen and fuel and all of that around. And we'll get a little bit into the alignment when we open up the CAD, but there's specific windows that they have to go in. And then number 4 are the composite modules. So 4A is the nitrogen module. 4B is avionics, so it's made out of fiberglass, which is why it's green. 4C and 4D are just general. We put those in because propulsion needed extra space. And then 5 are the isotanks. I can never remember which order they go in. I think LOX is on top.
IPA is on top.
IPA. Okay. So IPA is 5A, and then LOX is 5B, and then 6 is the fin can. And then you can see the cut through below it.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions on that? Okay. Cool. Let's keep going. Thanks for the quick overview.
Did we want to open up CAD now?
We will in a second. Let's go through the full report, and then we'll detail through the CAD.
Okay.
Okay. Von Karman nose cone. Keep going. Just get kind of scrolling through the report is a good idea because it'll help us come up with things to chat about. And the ERS and the pass-throughs. Good, good. Keep going. So you have a little chat about what each thing is. Great.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right. Great.
And this section is pretty much what the current design is, but we do have a section that talks about design history.
Great.
And then CFD.
Okay, yep, keep going. Okay, great. So you've got some of the CFD and FEA analysis right in the paper. That's really good.
Yeah, we have more in the appendices too. So
okay, good.
This is a long paper.
Good.
Here is the MDO results as of when I wrote this, May 30th.
Okay.
Which is not canonical according to Corey, so.
Yeah, that's right. It's not, but that's fine. Okay.
Yeah. And our final status. So we're about 24 and a half feet long. Mm-hmm.
Good. Okay.
Okay, let's go over references. All right, images, which we'll look at. This one I have posted in PSAS systems a while ago, but here it is again, just detailing this little bit that causes a headache for everyone. Yeah. So.
Good. And an arc clamp. Okay, good. Excellent.
No score.
Good. Okay. Yep. How much of the, did you guys talk about why you did it this way? Is there justification in these things as opposed to this is just how it is?
Uh-huh. We're just not there yet.
Okay, great. Keep going.
Okay, it's not, it's being slow. It is in Appendix C.
Concept analysis. Excellent.
Don't worry about Appendix B. Here we go. So images, comparing how they've changed over time, and also description.
All right. Great. Oh, so Appendix C is mostly your paper.
Yeah, we just weren't supposed to put that in the paper. It had to be in the appendix. Yeah,
that's perfectly fine. And so this is where we have the justification. So people mm-hmm. who are coming on to the LV4 project really should focus their attention on Appendix C. Okay.
Yes. Yep. It should also be noted, and we do have it in here, that they're just mass and volume placements, but just emphasis on like things like this that are inside are really just placeholders. So that is not what it actually looks like in real life.
Right. I kind of like the ring. That's pretty great.
Donuts.
It's the UFO RCS donut. It's good. Okay, good. Okay, good.
Okay, this is boss to y'all. Shit.
Priti, could you mute? Thanks. All right, great. Okay, and then the isogrids. And then the FEA for the analysis for the isogrid is where?
We will get to it.
Oh, okay, it's coming. All right.
Yes.
Okay, keep going.
Coupling rings and arc clamps and launch legs. Thrust plate is also initial, which we have in here. Some CFD, which we go into a little bit more detail on the fins later on. But I guess we did, we could talk about CFD, but CFD on the fins was done at both maximum velocity and maximum pressure, maximum dynamic pressure, to determine which one would have the least amount of drag and the least amount of pressure on the front of the fin. And was given to FEA to determine delamination. So, yep. And there's future work that needs to be done on that as well if people take CFD next year.
Hey, Katie, yes. The FEA that was done, so that was just at zero angle of attack?
Yes, we have not changed the angle of attack.
Okay, because that's really going to be the driving case is if the vehicle starts to go off.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And then we have FEA images, but we go into more detail later.
Related fin question. Did you try and plug things into the flutter formulas?
I think that is a Billy and or Corey question.
Okay. Are they here?
Billy is here, but his internet is going in and out. So we said to ask him on Slack.
Okay. I'll go send a message on Slack then.
Okay. I know
I can take the flutter question if you can hear me.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I think that was part of the MDO. I tried to do it for one of my papers, but I didn't have enough information to get an accurate determination of it. But I know that I had spoken with Corey, and it was something that with the MDO, he had all the information to do it.
Okay.
Good. Okay.
Training, blah blah blah, risk analysis. Yeah,
we did this with Austin. Awesome, good. Okay.
Yes, we did. And pretty much this is the biggest one, is a rapid unscheduled disassembly during boost is what we determined. If anyone is curious, so that's all the stuff. Don't worry about that. Okay, so this is where we get into CFD and FEA analysis on the fins. So this has all the information about the different types of fins, what was used to do CFD on them. Here's how they're modeled. So you can repeat the CFD. I also have my CFD files, so somebody can use those.
Great, and are those in the Google Drive?
Yes.
Great, good.
Yep. And the results, and then FEA information. So the stuff Billy did to do the FEA.
And Billy, all those CFD files are also in the Google Drive?
Yeah.
I don't know, guys. It looks like you actually did some work this year. It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
References. And then we've got launch lugs and FEA on those, okay. Which Matthew did redo with the accurate weight, not 7,000 pounds.
Okay, good.
Assuming that there's three launch lugs holding it in place, but he only did it on the bracket portion. He had issues modeling where it attaches to the coupling rings. So I think that's future work to determine if the fasteners will shear. And I think we have that in here, but basically the brackets will be fine. We added some fillets, but they don't have to be in there, but it's just, basically, if you want to cut these down, you can, and then the fillets will help. So they're pretty hefty right now. And then we've got the ISO tanks, and here's some of the FEA. So here's basically showing why we don't want a weld seam if we were to bend a flat plate, which we don't want to for many reasons. Some end cap FEA, and the end cap was made thicker because of the FEA results. But I think some of this FEA, at least on the ISO tanks, should be redone or looked into because I don't know what happened, but yeah, it was getting some weird results. It didn't look like that, so.
Yeah, that is weird, okay.
And then
you can skip over this, that's fine.
Yeah, just a little bit more information. Here's more information about ISO tanks, and that's it.
Excellent.
Yep.
thanks for the walkthrough. Let's move on to CAD.
Okay, I'm going to let Jim do this one.
Okay, I'll drive on this. Okay. So we can start at the top. I think the first thing to note here is our alignment with the planes of the CAD, and we are on a front plane, and that aligns.
Sorry, Jim, I'm going to interrupt for just a minute. Can you explain the folders structure of this whole thing?
Sure. Over here, we have a fastener folder, pots folder with all the different fasteners that are in it. Sorry, Onshape gets real slow when Zoom and Onshape are running at the same time. It's just not opening. So let's just, I'm frozen for a minute, but here we go. So we have the tank, we have fasteners in this folder, anything we had to import, and then we just go by sections. We have a nose cone section with the various nose cone parts and the sub-assemblies. Race pipes are here. They're named RP1 through RP4. And they have a little naming convention that shows where they go. So it's a little bit easier to figure out which one you're looking at.
That's great.
ISO tanks are here. And we have two separate sub-assemblies, one for locks, one for IPA.
Okay.
Composite modules here. And then each has a folder for each module. They use some of the, I believe, the regular modules. Let's see, how does this work? They're different sizes, so we're going to have different sub-assemblies. These are modeled in the way that we have an inner and outer carbon fiber with a Nomex layer, so they're modeled this way. So there's different layers, and then the assembly that puts it all together. One thing to note is, well, I'll get to that actually in a little bit. We have fins in this one with the different stuff that is needed for the fins. We have the two fin shapes that were studied, a smaller shape and a larger shape. Future Capstones maybe can determine if they want to get rid of one of these, but I believe we're using the smaller shape for this particular version of Rocket. So that's something to note.
I think it's the larger.
The smaller.
Okay.
Yeah, so maybe we might want to write down somewhere where, or maybe even rename this to say current or something, which is easy. We also have the FinCan folder, which is the assembly with a dummy engine, and propulsion modules, which are these new added pass-through modules here that allow for parts for propulsion. And then metal modules, which are the ones that contain all the different pass-through sub-assemblies that utilize each version of the pass-through. So we have an ERS and, here we go. We have the engine one, we have an RCS one, and then the other ones are part of the propulsion sub-assemblies. And then we have a rings folder with all the different parts of a composite coupling ring, the 3D printed chamfer that we use in this assembly, the thrust plates and all that, and bulkheads down here.
All right, click on the bulkheads for just a minute. Okay, good. So all the snowflakes are there. Okay, great. Thank you.
Yep.
Okay, and all this is pulled together in the main assembly. And then can you show us what the branch name for this is currently?
So I'm actually looking at my branch, but all this is in the main branch.
Okay,
great. We all still have our own branches in here.
So the main branch now has the canonical CAD for LV4.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Can we tag Onshape versions?
Yeah, you can make versions. Like you can see there's version 1 there, but we've been too afraid to.
Okay, I would like to make a version, don't have to do it right now, but called Capstone Handoff. And that will be essentially what you guys are delivering, so we can always go back to that one if we screw it up in the future. Okay.
Do you want to call it like Capstone 2021 in case we do a future Capstone?
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, Peter.
And the other thing I would note while Onshape freaks out is, so we did it differently than LV3.1 does Onshape, because we did all of our CAD in one workspace, like you see here. And it's been nice because then you just work on everything all in one thing and you only have to merge the one workspace. But the downside is the more tabs you have, the slower it gets, which is why it's so slow right now. If we wanted to bring in like propulsion stuff, there's just no room for it in this workspace. Mm-hmm. So that's just something to keep in mind, like what we want to do in the future. If we just want to move the CAD over and do it like LV3.1 or whatever. But I mean, overall, it was nice working this way because you can just see everything. It's just slower.
Mm, interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, how does LV3 do it compared to this? Because this seems like the right way to do it.
So I can show you actually so Jim doesn't have to reload it all. So give me a minute.
Mm-hmm.
So LV3 has the folders separate. And so when you go to Airframe, it's just the Airframe in the workspace.
Ah, I understand. Okay.
Yeah. So if you wanted to work on like an RCS part, you have to go to that part separately, and then you can only merge like that part. So you have to do it for every part that you work on. Whereas here you can work on 10 different parts and only merge once. So it's a lot easier.
Okay. Yeah, we should probably change that for LV3, but for LV4 with flips, probably do it something more like that. Okay.
Yeah. So I was thinking like just, basically take the full assembly, put that in a new workspace, take the propulsion assembly and put that in. So you're just moving over the full assembly. So you have a workspace with just the assemblies in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Excellent. All right. Let's continue with the CAD walkthrough.
Yeah. And I'm not sure also if we get rid of all our branches, if that will help speed it up down the road, you know. I'm not sure about that.
I would be surprised if it helps speed things up, but you can go ahead and close the branches tab. Okay, thanks.
Okay, so now we're at the assembly. I just wanted to note before we look at the different parts is just the alignment here from the previous versions. We are now aligned with the front plane, so you can see now that we have our window number one indexing on the pass-throughs as normal to the front plane. And then the back plane will contain the launch lugs.
Can you flip around so we can see that?
Yep. Onshape doesn't really want to show them to you, but you can kind of see. There you go.
There you go. Okay. So window number one faces forward. Windows number seven faces backwards. Okay. Against the rail. Cool. All right.
Yeah.
And it looks like every other window in the pass through is aligned with a ring. Yeah. So
with an arc clamp. Yep.
Thank arc clamp. So there are 12 windows and 6 arc clamps. Is that true?
Yep. Yeah. And so the launch lugs go over window 7 and the race pipes can go in any odd window that isn't number 7.
Right. And that's because it's being forced to be in the center of one of the 6 clamps.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah.
So can you zoom in on that for a second?
Yeah. Okay. And that way we don't have to sacrifice any of our connections here.
Yeah. Might be a good time to point out the arrows.
Getting there, yeah. Onshape is being really slow right now. I can't even zoom out yet. But yeah, there are also an arrow indexing, which as soon as on-chip behaves, I'll show. There we go. And the pass-through modules, all the coupling rings and pass-through modules also have these arrow indexing to indicate where you want the seam of the first arc lamp to go. Just basically to indicate the starting point or the ending point.
So those are actually in the CAD, those arrows?
Yeah, they're engraved. The same way we do the ORSAT engraving.
Great. Okay, so the purpose of that is just to show where the first arc clamp starts.
Yes, because if you don't have the arc clamps on here, there's a lot of holes to align, and if you're not really sure where they're going to go, you could accidentally start putting these on in a different location. So.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Okay, that's great. Good.
Yep. And the other thing too was this way all the bulkheads will be aligned. So if you want to pass cords through, they'll pass through the same part of the bulkhead.
Great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which if we want to look at a section view, we can see that.
Hey, Joe, when we make the LV3 modules, are the coupling rings aligned in a particular direction on both sides?
They are, yeah.
Is there like a mark on the mandrel that does that, or do you just do it outside of that?
They are just, I think it's six-fold symmetry. Or, you know, N equals six rotational symmetry on the mandrel. Does that answer your question?
I think so, yeah. So there are marks on the mandrel where, like, you can align it, and it's, like, I guess what you're saying is, like, there's six possible rotations that fit.
Yeah. And the rings have N equals 12 symmetry, so there's no, on the LV3.1 rings, there's no like arrow to align things, because there would be no point. If you wanted an arrow to align things on the LV3.1 modules, you'd just have to like draw it on with tape.
Got it. Thanks.
Good. Okay. Why don't you leave it open like this? This is actually a good way to start walking through. All right. Let's start with the nose cone tip.
Okay. We have our tip here and a modeled wedge. Wasn't able to completely mimic how the layup will look, but this wedge, I believe, holds the layup materials between the nose cone tip and this wedge, which gives it an attachment point. And then we move down here. We shorten this flat cylindrical section to be 1 inch. It appears that it is lots of space in here, so we made that as short as we can. I probably could even go a touch shorter, but I just thought an inch was probably short enough. And then we have within here our dummy ERS system, which obviously will be a future capstone maybe. Mm-hmm. And a twist coupling ring to hold these two modules together.
Ah, so you sized the LV3 ERS ring to be LV4 sized.
Yeah, but I didn't include any gear. I didn't model any gears or anything because we don't know what the system is going to look like. This just is, yeah, basically a placeholder just to show that there's a way to connect these two.
Good.
Okay, and then we, nothing else really to show in there. So we move down to the RCS system. And again, we have this dummy mass in here. Placeholder.
Actually, let's zoom in on the ring the ring clamp system just for a second, since this is the first time we've seen it. Can we go between the RCS and the ERS and zoom in on one of the ring clamps for a second? So these are LV3.1 style clamps. They're flush on the surface. They're machined aluminum. Can you open up the assembly on one of them so we can take a look at them? Assembly is the wrong word, part, sorry.
Just individual?
Yeah, I think you can right click on it and say go to part or whatever it's called.
I also have a sub-assembly that is just two rings with arc clamps and launch lugs on them.
Oh, that'd be interesting to see. Okay.
Do you want to share that?
Unless I deleted it. I don't remember. let's see. But while it's loading, they're inspired by LV3.1, but obviously they're different because the thickness is a lot smaller. And then also the CAD shows that they're interfering, but I did a ton of trig on them and they shouldn't be. But the CAD likes to show weird things. So I don't know which one can be trusted, but a 3D print might be good. Here we go. Okay. Okay, so the clearance here, can't even really see, but the clearance from the bottom to this part is different from the clearance here. I wrote that in the paper. I don't remember off the top of my head what it is. But all of that, we have all the CAD is done with variables. And so the clearance is in there. And you can also see like some of the math that I did to calculate this stuff. It's a pain in the butt.
Cool. I'm just curious why it's not flat. Is that a CAD rendering issue? Yeah. Or is it? Okay.
It's CAD. Right.
Okay, great.
Yeah. There's
and then CAD stuff. Pull up an arc clamp just to independently.
Do you want the assembly? Or just the individual one?
Just an individual arc clamp.
Okay. So the CAD, I made all of the arc clamps in one thing. So basically what you have to do is you just hide the ones you don't want to look at, and then you can view the ones you do want to look at. So if you get confused, yeah. So they're all here.
Okay. And so this is got there's eight number four fasteners that hold this thing in place and zip around to the other side. And it's just the same. Okay, great, thanks. And then go back to the assembly for a second. And we're supposed to have helicoils in the rings, correct?
They are in the rings, yep.
Okay, great. And Onshape doesn't really show helicoils, is that true? So there's just a hole that's the right size?
Oh, we have them in.
So it shows the helicoils, but it does not make the holes for them. And so what we did was, we made the hole before the threads, I believe. We have it in the paper. Okay. But so you'll need to note in the manufacturing drawing to tap for 440 helicoils.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
I can show it here, Kenny. Yeah. So here you can actually see the helicoils and the screw inside. So there's the helicoil.
Yeah, excellent.
There's the screw.
Okay, thanks. With 1,100 screws, we're going to need an army of undergraduates to take this thing apart. It's going to be hilarious.
Yeah. there's a couple screws.
Yeah. All right. Thanks for just doing a quick view in zoom in on that. Anybody else have questions about this?
I have a question. So I notice the like aspect ratios of everything on the clamps has changed a bunch. So the clamps themselves are like broader and thinner, and the flange that clamped everything together is a lot smaller. Is that just a consequence of going to a thinner ring?
Yes. So we went to the thinner ring, and then I posted in Slack as I was designing this, and you and Peter kept telling me what to do. So this is also based on what you guys told me. So so you can go through that thread to look at design decisions. But someone should really, again, 3D print it, because like the CAD is kind of funky and there's a lot of weird math to check it out. But yeah, I mean, it's thin. Like that whole wall is a quarter inch.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, and this is an important note for people listening in, which is a lot of these design discussions are in Slack, and the history will continue to be there, which is great. Okay. All right, let's continue.
Okay, so where do we leave off? We left off at RCS. Mm-hmm. RCS right now, we just have, let me turn off the section view just so we can see. We have the nozzles, as we're calling them, out of certain windows. So I believe we have four evenly spaced around the rocket. And let me just get back to my front view here. And sorry, everything is so slow. And then we go down to our nitrogen module, N2 module. And,
all right, and let's do a quick overview of the composite module. So do you want to take a section view of that, and we'll talk about the layers and maybe open up the subassembly?
Okay. So we, like I mentioned before, these are modeled where there's three distinct layers. We have an inner carbon fiber layer, which is really thin, Nomex layer, and an outer carbon fiber layer.
And then our adorable little 3D printed ring is right up there at the very interface.
There it is. This little chamfer ring.
Yep.
Go. And all the composite modules are modeled the same way. Obviously, the avionics will be our fiberglass, not carbon fiber, but
so one of the things that came up, this is a little bit of a tangent, when I first got my hands on one of the ISO tanks, is how amazingly lightweight it is. And one of the questions we've got is, are they more lighter weight than the composite modules? Do we have a sense of at least the relative difference in weight between the two kinds of modules?
That isn't something we really looked at.
Should be important to note that for flight, the ISO tanks are going to need to be covered with a wrap and insulation.
Yes, for sure. Which will make them more heavy.
Yeah, that is a good point. I don't know if there's a way to directly compare them in our CAD, because we don't have any two that are similarly sized. We could just look at our density if we want. So let me see here.
If you can basically get like a weight per length, then you can do some comparisons between them.
Yeah, let's not worry about that right now. But that's a future thing to do, is to do a sanity check on what we think the different weights will be. And we'll probably end up building one to get a real world comparison. I think that will be important. Going up to a bulkhead for just a minute, or a snowflake, whatever you want to call it. those guys are, can you do, yeah, okay, good. So they're right below or above the rings. There is one on each end of the module. And these are just scaled from LV3, right?
They were scaled from LV3, and I made some design tweaks to it to make it a little bit lighter and still feel kind of robust. And I made it a little skinnier to not interfere with any of these fasteners here.
Yeah, good. So, okay. They are unfortunately still massive and probably more than we need, but that's a good placeholder for now. Another thing that came up is the ability to actually make isogrid bulkheads. So instead of doing this, the cute snowflakes, we actually just make an isogrid bulkhead.
With cutouts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Actually, the interesting thing is one of the problems with the cutouts is they have to be filled so that things can't fall down the rocket if they get loose, right? And so with the isogrid, we might actually leave the webbing in there and then only perforate through it for connectors and wires and things like that. But whatever, that's all fine. All right, thanks. Keep going.
Okay, so that brings us down to the N2 tank. We have a dummy mass up here. And
what's the dummy mass for?
Because there will be propulsion things.
Ah,
so we wanted to fill that space. Outside of this tank. This tank came from a CAD that a company sent me. I don't have the name of the company off the top of my head, but it is all that information was sent to the propulsion team. So I think they might have that probably written down in their paper, I would assume. Maybe, mm-hmm. maybe not. If not, we can put that in Slack.
They've got it.
Okay. So we have that modeled in here. It looks like they kind of modeled it solid, so that's something to look at. Then we have another bulkhead, and that brings us to the camera module. Camera module is going to be pretty full. We have not only do we have the cameras, but we also have a race pipe in there. At least one race pipe. Let's turn the section view off. We have two race pipes, three race pipes, and cameras.
So let's open up a pass-through module by itself for just a minute.
And do the race pipes need to be relocated with propulsion?
I don't know if they need them relocated.
Okay.
I'm sure the answer is yes.
Yeah.
Okay, can you pull up just the aluminum part for just a minute? Great, okay, and zoom in one of the windows. Okay, so this whole thing is 6 inches tall, I think. Is that what we decided?
Let's measure. I don't have that off the top of my head.
You said 1,100 screws on this thing?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's 4 inches. Okay.
4 inches tall. 1,100 more screws.
Yep. Sorry, but lots more holes than screws, Felix. So there's probably like 5,000 screw holes. So not everything you see here will actually have a screw in it.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so zoom in on the window for just a minute. And so the whole thing's 4 inches tall, which is cool. Okay, and then that is, and kind of rotate up so we can see that one of the lips on the bottom to see the shape. Okay, great. And if I remember right, none of those holes are threaded that goes through to the back.
Yeah, we're going to use helicoils in the window cover holes.
Oh, there are helicoils there.
Yeah, there will be helicoils in those.
All right, can you show us the assembly with the window covers? Okay, great. And then okay, so the window covers are flat. They don't go inside the module at all. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, so nice and flush there on the outside surface.
All right, thanks.
Are the window covers aluminum?
Currently, yes.
Oh. Okay. They should be probably 3D printed nylon SLS.
Yeah, I would think we could probably get away with that for most of them. Maybe not where the race pipe, or actually maybe even the race pipes, because they're not physically connecting to them. I think right. If you have anything robust on there, maybe you can make that one aluminum, but
I think one other thing that might need to be changed before we go to manufacturing or something like this is the corners probably need to have some sort of radius.
Which corners?
Oh,
the window corners.
Yep, right in there.
Do they? I don't think they have them on LV3. Do they? I can go look.
Yeah, I see what you mean, though. It is a very sharp corner right here.
Oh, and it's more about the on the inside, when you make the metallic piece, you're going to drive up your cost trying to achieve such a small radius.
Right, which we don't need at all.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, because I think these were based on LV3s, so I don't know if LV3 had them and we just missed that, or LV3 does not have them.
The reason they're sharp on LV3 was because of a particular request from a machinist, because they had a particular operation in mind. I think they were using like a cutting wheel rather than a ball end mill. And so they were going to end up with a very sharp corner there.
That's interesting. Design? Yeah, I could see that if they're using the slotting wheel, that would work out there.
I have a question. Is that area pressurized?
No.
Okay, because you know I'm worried about basically just like they ran into problems on the early high-flying jets. Basically, the problem was on high-flying jets, when they made rectangular corners, they found that a lot of the windows were breaking. And the reason is there was stress there when they pressurized the inside.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. And the, what was that? Lockheed? No, it wasn't a Lockheed.
No, it was the
it was the Comet. Yeah, the Huffman Comet.
That's it.
Yeah, there was a lot of accidents. They figured that out.
Luckily, nothing here is pressurized except for the LOX tanks.
Oh, okay, sorry, that's what I wanted to ask. Thank you.
All right. You can jump back out to the main assembly.
Okay. I also want to note, too, for future capstones, that we are using a main pass-through assembly here to within different sub-assemblies. So we're using like a model one. That might want to get looked at as parameters change, and they might have to basically copy and make individual ones for each different subassembly. Right now, that's not the way it's modeled. I just wanted to make a note of that for future capstones. Okay. So we're still at the camera module. That is going to be crowded in there. So I can imagine that parameter maybe changing or maybe doubling up or something. Back to section view. Okay, so there's our camera module. We move down through the camera module, and now we're in our avionics module. And just note we have the three pipes with pipe clamps here.
Would you guys expect pipe clamps to go where all the raceways are? So if you look at the bottom of the avionics module, the raceway runs right by an arc clamp but is not attached.
That will probably be a determination for how thick these pipes end up being ultimately, and if somebody wanted to do an like a flutter analysis on them or something to see if that's an issue. If these are pretty rigid, I would imagine you maybe need one, but I don't know if you would need one at every single arc clamp, but that might be something another capstone could look at as well.
Yeah. Okay, good. Thanks.
Also, real quick with the race pipe clamps. So there's the two sizes, but Jim, if you just want to zoom in to one of them, I don't know if you can tell from here, but there's a little piece of rubber that goes in and it's black, and it's actually two pieces so that you can actually clamp it in and not have to worry about one piece of rubber. Or you can just do one and like basically epoxy it in place or something, but I have it modeled as two, so.
Great.
I think.
And that's a good point. And that brings me to another point too, is that the distance from the body is dictated by the pipe clamp of this pipe, but you might have, if you have different turn radiuses here, this might change the way this needs to be modeled. It might need to be pulled out, pulled in, depending on this bend radius to get through a window.
Or you can change the window cover.
Or you can change the window cover, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. 3D printing a weird ovoid shape into the cover would be fine, you'd think. Cool. Okay.
Yeah. This might seem a little pedantic, but where did the name race pipes come from? I've heard of cable raceways, but usually the fuel lines on rockets are called feed lines or something like that. So I was just curious where that came from.
That's a good question, Peter. I think I personally heard it way back. Somebody just said it, and then I think it just stuck with all of us.
I think it was Andrew, because Andrew never knows how to say anything.
Wait, what?
Fair enough.
So what should we call them, Peter?
I think typically they're called feed lines.
Okay, so you guys go back and relabel all the things, redo your entire report.
Just more curious where the term came from, and that's like maybe this is something I don't know, but
I assumed it was a proprietary PSAS naming convention.
No, I think it came from a mix up of a raceway, a cable raceway, and pipes.
I mean,
it sounds fast.
I was going to say race pipes makes it sound faster. So. Okay.
Also, Billy just got back, but I was just going to say that CubeSat avionics cradle is also vaporware that Billy made.
Yeah, TBD on the sizing of all this.
Yeah, that's fine. But that is a 3U CubeSat, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and then there's just a sort of a plate on the top and the bottom that holds the CubeSat in place. Yeah, okay, perfect. That's all we need. Okay.
Yep. Okay, so that we are in the avionics module, I guess we'll move on. Now we have a propulsion pass-through, I guess what we're calling it, propulsion module, which we're calling both these pass-throughs and the composite module, calling this propulsion module. Just treat it like one piece, I guess, but that will most likely change down the road, I'm assuming. And then that brings us to our ISO tank, our first ISO tank, which is our IPA tank, which here we have isopropyl alcohol modeled in here. So it's a relatively full tank. Placeholder, and I don't know if you want to see or anybody has.
I want to do a quick overview on how the ISO tanks are built. It's probably the most complicated piece I'd imagine of this thing. So, is there anything you guys want to tell us about how these ISO tanks are created or catted up?
Yes. So Melissa did this, and Peter can probably hop in. But the CAD is not used to machine them. Because there's a lot of difficulties in doing the CAD, especially in Onshape, because you have a pattern and it just takes a lot of computational power that Onshape just cannot handle. And so for a little bit, it was done in SOLIDWORKS. And then the other issue is if you don't model it correctly, then the ribs are not basically perpendicular, kind of, because it's circular, but you want them to be relatively perpendicular to the wall and then parallel to each other, the ribs. So so the ribs are like where the wall is. And so if you don't model them right, then they might be kind of like not parallel to each other. And so modeling was hard with that and with the computational power. So Peter is using a CAM software to make them separately. So CAD is basically a placeholder.
So I think this got lost somewhere in our back and forths, but so the final manufacturing process basically does the same thing as the wrap feature. And so now we while the ribs aren't parallel perfectly as they're manufactured, they're close enough given the large diameter. So I guess the CAD and what was manufactured is now diverged a little bit. So if we do future CAD models of the ISO tank, I think we would just go back to using the wrap feature.
Okay. Yeah. So that was Melissa. So, okay. Yeah, and I think the other thing that I'm noticing, I don't know if you have the fillets in the tank, but I noticed this doesn't have any fillets on it.
Yeah, the tank does have the correct fillets as manufactured. I do want to give props to Melissa for getting this done. Like, this would be the ideal thing to do, and it is ridiculously hard to do this.
Yeah, so that's just to further expand on this is too, is like, this is the limitations of Onshape too. We can only model so much in Onshape. If we get too computationally heavy, it just can't do it.
So I would also like to point out that although this particular CAD model isn't used for manufacturing, there is an exception, and that is the end caps.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, we did. I did use the CAD to directly manufacture it from that.
Yeah, and the end caps don't have the issue with the wrap feature or any of that. So, yeah. And then the seam is where the two tanks will be welded together. So it doesn't show that, not there, but the tank seam. Yeah. So it's technically two tanks in real life.
Did you guys CAD them up as two? You didn't CAD them up as two things.
No, it's just one tank with a seam in it.
Yeah. Okay, good. Can you show the bulkhead again and the weld area with the bulkhead?
End cap?
Yeah, sorry. The raceway piping conduit weld.
This is the race weld.
Okay. And then can you section view it for a second?
No porn.
All right, just zoom into the corner for a second. Oh, I like to see the alcohol. That's hilarious. Okay. Oops, sorry, zoom out just a little bit. All right, great. I just wanted to see the fillet and where those two things actually get welded together. Okay. And then the welding mice go through the tank and then weld the inside, right?
Very yeah.
Small welding mice. Okay, thanks. Anything else you guys on the ISO tanks and the design or anything that we should know?
I don't have anything else.
Okay.
I guess because we don't have the fillets or the node holes, I guess the CAD doesn't really give a representative weight for the cylindrical section.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah.
All right, so future project is redo that. Oh, and this is with a wrap, right? This is a single layer of carbon fiber around it?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, so we're at the IPA tank, moving down to another propulsion module with more race pipes or feed lines. It's gonna be a hard habit to break. And our first launch lug also was here.
And I think the locations might need to change now that we've added some modules, but I don't know.
Of the pipes?
No, of the launch lugs.
Of the launch lugs, yeah. That might be something to look at down the road as well, is launch lug location. So right now we have one here, and one down at the bottom.
Okay.
With additional modules, actually, we have a little bit of flexibility. You know, we could put it here, we could even move it up, depending on what we want to do. So yeah, again, propulsion module, then we go down to our LOX tank, and LOX tank is almost identical to the IPA, just not in length.
And actually, real quick, now that I'm thinking about it, it might also be a good future FEA work, because I think when he did the FEA on the launch legs, he just divided the weight by three, but there's going to be a moment arm, so maybe kind of accounting for that when it's holding the rocket horizontally.
Mm-hmm. That's a good, good point.
Yeah. How did you look at insulation around the LOX tank? Is there insulation in there?
There is not any insulation modeled in here.
Okay.
So I think we've been talking about the possibility of filling it with like foam.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I don't think it's modeled, but yeah.
Just, okay, that's fine.
Yeah. And then we have another pass through with the pipes coming in here to feed the motor. And then we have our fin cam.
And currently, the fins are attached on the surface just like LV3, correct? Yeah.
That's correct.
All right.
Emmy and Hayden, do you two have any questions?
I have just a logistical question. So you've talked a little bit about some of the benefits and not so benefits of Onshape. Can you talk about why you made the decision of Onshape versus SolidWorks?
Yeah, so it wasn't in particular Onshape versus SolidWorks, more so Onshape versus GitHub. And I don't think I need to explain that to you, but Onshape, you don't have to be pushing anything. The merging is a lot easier and you can restore things. So if something goes wrong, Jim, do you want to show how to do that or do you want me to?
You mean the merging into a different branch?
No, restoring. So if you, let's say that Jim did something in main that he doesn't want to do anymore. So click on show changes. And then click on any of them in the list. Yeah. So you can undo, obviously, but if it's like 10 steps or something and you don't want to, or you won't let you undo or something like that, eventually once this loads, it will have restore to main up there, and you can click on that and it'll basically restore back to whatever it was. So if you click like 20 days ago, you can restore that to main. So it's a lot easier. And then you can also force merge if somebody disappears. You're not losing all their work because, you know, people don't like to push to GitHub, as we all know. And so you can also go in and look at other people's branches. You don't have to wait for them to merge. Yeah. You just have a lot more control. Yeah, so you can see restore to main. So.
The secret truth, Emmy, is that this capstone was a guinea pig to see if Onshape could really work for what we needed. I think it was successful, actually. I think I'm pretty pleased. It wasn't perfect, that's for sure. But it's online. Anybody can run it with, because it's an educational free account. It's not, doesn't have all SolidWorks features, but then you also don't need a computer that can run SolidWorks, which is a serious problem for a lot of students.
You can also
I was going to just add to the things that were said about, you know, the learning curve in Onshape is not as steep as SolidWorks, especially if you know SolidWorks. It takes a little bit of time to get comfortable with it, but it's not, it's a little bit more user-friendly in terms of getting started in the learning curve. It does have some limitations, but it is great to be able to see, like if I'm coming in here to work, I can see, oh wait, Katie was working today and she's working on this part I need. So I know that she was in here. And it's just really nice to see what everybody's up to because it will help help merge things later on down the line, just knowing where everybody's at. And it's just a little bit easier for collaboration.
You can also go back, unless you delete it, but you can go back and see how things have changed over time. So I don't know if I have a good part, but if you continue to do work on the same part and not delete and start a new one, then you can compare and with like a little slider, which I can pull one up for the rings and show you what I mean. But that is really fun for like if you want to use it in a presentation or something.
That's really cool.
Yeah, which I will get once this loads, but yeah.
I mean, there's definitely things Onshape can't do that SolidWorks can, but most of the time it didn't limit our ability to work on parts. I would say maybe just with the ISO tanks was the biggest thing, our biggest part that had issues with it.
You guys are kind of talking about like the ease of it merging different branches and stuff like that. Does it, do you run into merge conflicts at all? And is that like easy enough to deal with?
I don't think we had any merge conflicts.
The only issue is if somebody deletes something that they shouldn't have deleted, because it will delete it for everyone. I mean, the same with SolidWorks, but you can just restore it. So as long as you are like really checking, I mean, you don't need like the GitHub master or whatever like we have for Orsat, but you should have somebody who is checking the CAD to make sure that like everything is there and everything is cleaned up, so that if something goes wrong, you can restore it.
Katie, are you going to show us something or should we move on?
I am trying to, but you can move on and then I can show you when I get it to work.
So I actually do have a question. So would you choose to do this again, you guys, with Onshape?
I would.
Yep.
Good. Okay. So success, vaguely.
Yeah,
I would say the.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Billy.
I would say that the its attributes far outweigh its shortcomings.
The most important is, was any of this rocket designed on a phone? I think that's most important because they do have the app. Never mind. Okay, you gonna show something, Katie?
Yes, Jim, you have to let me share my screen. Okay, so you can compare, this is in the visitor branch, but you can see how, unfortunately it shows all my crappy planes, but you can see how it's changed over time.
Oh, that is cool.
And I guess the only other downside with Onshape is like you can see we needed a lot of planes to do things that you could easily do in SolidWorks. So sometimes like just getting things in the right place and then mating is completely different, which is a little weird to get used to. Some people prefer it. I prefer my good old take three mates to do it, but this one you just need one mate, but you just have to align it right. So it's a little funky, a little bit of differences.
Yeah, and I will note this version history doesn't work if you make a whole new subassembly or a whole new assembly. Like,
yeah, if you make a new part or a new assembly, you can't compare it to a different part or assembly. So you can only compare the same thing. So you can see here's the old coupling ring right here on the left, and that I deleted that. It doesn't exist anymore, so I can't look at it. I can look at arc clamps because those still exist and see how those have changed over time. They moved. So yeah,
good. Okay, last thoughts on the CAD assembly. Other questions, Hayden, Emmy?
Also the thrust plate and all the engine stuff, I don't know if we mentioned it, but all that needs to be worked out with propulsion. That's all really vaporware.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that. If it says propulsion, it's vaporware, which makes total sense. That's fine.
Yeah.
Are you able to see my screen right now?
Yeah.
Okay. Zoom wasn't showing me the band around the screen. Okay. Anything else we want to look at in the assembly?
I guess kind of like on a detailed perspective, what's the point of kind of that? I'd seen it a few times. I think Andrew, you almost called it like a snowflake looking thing. What was the point of that versus just like a full like circular bulkhead?
Yep. So Andrew's calling it a snowflake because it kind of looks like one. Mm-hmm. This is your mounting surface for components inside.
Okay, so it has to have those cutouts so that way stuff can fit in there?
Yeah, stuff can pass through. And that's another thing that will have to happen that Andrew was talking about was like LV3 has plates for these opening when you don't need an opening so things don't fall through if that's an issue. But yeah, we have the mounting holes here, mounts outside the module. And you know, some of the work on this was just making these, just trying to make this a little bit lighter, making these openings as big as we can, but still have enough material to be strong enough for the mounting holes.
And in particular, Hayden, the meta question you're asking is on the pass-through modules, you could always attach things to the walls, which we do occasionally, but it's just easier to mount the things to a plate. And so we found that these are good. We use them on LV3. You'll see that we use them on mostly the bottoms of the pass-through modules where we mount batteries and electronics and things like that. And especially in the carbon fiber composite modules, well, any composite module, you can't really attach to the walls. And so you need something to hold all your crap in place.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah, and right now these things are sitting at 1.67 pounds, so I'm sure they could.
Yeah, we could lose.
Go on a little bit more of a diet, get a little skinnier. Then you could even do an FEA on these with like at maximum acceleration to determine if they're strong enough for the heaviest part.
It's one of the exciting ideas about moving to ISO grids instead of composites. I don't think we will, but if we did, we could mount things directly to the airframe because the ISO grid has those holes for, you know, what, number eights or something. So that would be pretty great.
All right, well, while we're still in CAD, does anybody want to look at anything else? Any other parts that are interesting to them or want to know more about?
I have a few questions about the race pipes and then the ISO tanks. So let's see, you've got nitrogen pressure running to the oxygen tank and the IPA tank. Are those two different lines?
Yep. There's a line that brings nitrogen to the engine pass through, one that brings it to LOX and one that brings it to IPA.
Would there be any way to combine the oxygen and IPA since the bulkheads are pretty close together?
That's a propulsion question.
Okay.
And the answer is you wouldn't want that because that would be a direct line between your fuel and your oxidizer, which is always a terrible idea. Because things go.
Yeah, it is best to keep those two apart until you want the combustion to happen.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. And then for the ISO tank, is there a reason the ISO grid is on the outside of the tank versus the inside?
Yeah, so pretty much you can't machine inside a cylinder.
Okay, you can't machine inside the cylinder. Okay.
Yep. And there are some other options that were explored, and I wrote a paper on that for STAR, so we have that in the STAR folder, but basically cylinders machining directly onto the outside of a cylinder is pretty much just the best option for cost and manufacturing and also stress. So, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, unfortunately, it would act as a baffle on the inside, which is pretty cool. And we haven't even talked about baffles, but that's a future capstone. All right, you guys, I think we're done with CAD, unless anybody else has any other questions. All right, wasn't somebody open up the Google Drive and share their screen?
Yeah, I can do that. Okay.
Oh God, can you click the little upper right hand thing so it's actually a list and not a bunch of pictures? Thank you.
Okay.
Oof, phew, so much better. Okay, so you've got your progress reports and a couple of presentations and some stuff in here. Go into the FEA folder for a moment. Okay, so these are all the FEA parts. Go back and go to CFD. Great, okay. And then go back to the root folder. And what I'd like to see here is, the final capstone report should be here. It would be, it's right there. Is that it?
Yeah, that's it. The final report is the final report, yes.
Excellent, okay. So then what is that last shortcut down below?
This one is the one that you made for class. So I don't know where you made it, but the one that you gave Ike when we do the proposal.
Oh, that's the proposal. I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah. Oh, that's fine, because that's actually in the capstone folder, which is fine. If you could link your star paper here using a shortcut, Katie, that would be really nice.
Okay.
I'm trying to make sure that the main documents are exactly where you'd expect them to be, but for all the ancillary stuff, like, you know, your reports and things like that, or the star paper that directly attaches to this, we can just put those in the right place and then use shortcuts to link to them. And do we have everybody's from your capstones, you know, little class reports in here as well?
Yes. They're all in FEA and CFD. The only thing is if we updated them, so the CFD and launch like FEA were updated after these reports. So, but they are correct in the paper.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's it.
Yeah. We can't really go over CFD or FEA since nobody has taken those classes yet. So.
Yeah. Okay.
Out of curiosity, did they have you do a symposium this year, or how did that work?
We had recorded videos that we submitted, and that was it.
I don't know if you can put a shortcut to a YouTube video. I assume you can't, but that would be another good place thing to have in here.
I think we can upload it, or Billy, you can upload it. Or I can.
That'd be great, Billy. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah,
we can't hear you.
No, there was. Type it in the chat, Billy.
Billy's computer is not happy.
Yeah, the motor hornets are getting him. Okay. You guys, congratulations. Any other questions from the audience? That was really good. You guys mostly met the objectives. You've met them based on a lot of slow work from other people. So that was really good, including the MDO and including flips and all that kind of stuff. So I'm actually pleased. I think that you guys hit your, you hit our performance or our deliverables. That was what was really important, which was deliver a CAD model that wasn't just vaporware, but we could actually build. So excellent. Do you guys have any feedback for us as PSAS?
Yes, I do. So I think, and I mean, this was kind of, I think a lot of us had different ideas of going in, but one thing was we had like the clear expectations in terms of what you submitted to Ike, but then beyond that, there was a lot of different expectations from different people who were like Corey and Peter expected us to be doing something. And then we were like, well, that's not what we think we're supposed to be doing. So maybe just having a little bit more clear expectations of who is doing what, because as a capstone, we do have a ton of other stuff to do. So sometimes it can just be a little bit difficult to manage all of that. And then also and I mentioned this before, but FEA is, what term is that? That is in fall term, but then CFD and advanced FEA are not until winter term. So just keeping that in mind as like, we do have projects for those classes, but they can't really be too in depth because we're just learning it. Yeah,
we need super seniors is what we need. People who've taken the senior classes and then come to do their capstones.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, Katie, do you have a specific example of expectations that Corey and I had that were outside of what you all expected?
I don't know off the top of my head. I don't think it was anything. I mean, it's not like terrible. It was just kind of like where people will be like, oh, well, are you guys doing this? And we're like, I thought you were doing this. And so just kind of going back and forth, it's like, well, who is supposed to be doing this? And I can't think of anything specifically, but it just happened a few times. So, yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think on giant system level projects like this, it's super hard to pin down who's doing what, especially given the fact that you guys are trying to shed work because you've got so much other work to do. And each of us has our own agenda about what you guys should be working on. I'm sure for Peter, you guys should have done more FEA on the tanks. And for me, you should have put more detail in the CAD and like, you know, this kind of thing, right? So good.
Yeah, I would like to maybe just expand on that a little bit, like what the advanced FEA being in the winter and also CFD being in the winter, by the time we're comfortable with at least doing a simulation, like I can relate it to CFD, we're already in our spring term and we're starting to run out of time. So I think maybe having like one substantial thing that analysis maybe is looking at, it might be the way to go. Just because it takes, like CFT takes so long to set up a simulation, especially when you just learned it. I was running into that with NoseCone. I was hoping to do more alternate versions of the NoseCone and get more simulation results, but I just literally ran out of time. I wasn't able to do it.
Yeah. And I would say also, so we have two meetings a week, for the past year, but none of them were the PSAS meetings. And so that's why like me and Jim were usually the only ones that came to the PSAS and the LV4 meetings. Mm-hmm. And I would say, try to make one, I would still suggest two meetings a week, but try to make one of them a PSAS meeting, which might be hard. But then it was just really difficult to like go and take stuff back to the group. And then there's stuff that like, I didn't know. And I think if we were to do those with like the PSAS or the LV4 meetings, then not just doing CAD reviews, but also doing CFD and FEA reviews where people have to explain the choices that they make just to make sure, because there's a lot of FEA stuff that I don't know. So I can't say like if that's right and you like rocket stuff. So like we didn't catch the 7,000 pounds until last week. Yeah, that's just a general suggestion for future capstones.
Yeah, it's a good suggestion, actually.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So I have a question. If we should delay this until the students have had more training and move through their courses, how do we accomplish this? In other words, how would, suppose, you know, we waited till everybody's had the courses, how would we do this kind of a design, which is needed if we wanted to do the rocket?
Or maybe I don't think we're saying that you have to delay it, but more so keep in mind that, like, we do have, because so CFD and FEA classes, you do a final project and it can be on anything. So we did a final project that was related to the capstone, but just know that it has to be really basic because people are just learning it. And so if you want more in-depth FEA and CFD, it would have to be a grad student.
Yeah, that's really the problem, Ed, is that it basically, right, they just learned it and now we want them to do advanced analysis. That's a good point. Actually, having a grad student work with a capstone team to run simulations for them and with them is actually a brilliant idea.
And I would be willing to do CFD next year.
Yeah, I will say if I had a grad student to talk to about CFD, just like when I got stuck on things, would have been priceless for me.
Yes.
Interesting. Okay, good.
Okay, it's a good answer. I mean, so yeah, we learned something.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Capstone team. Congratulations. You have officially handed off your capstone. LV4 is now in new hands. We look forward for you guys being around and helping out and answering questions in the years to come. We'll hunt you down via however we hunt people down. If you get an aerospace job, don't forget that there's something called the PSAS tithe, where 10% of your income comes back to PSAS. I love that. Thank you. Thank you guys for a successful capstone.
It's been a trip. Recording. All right.
Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you. It was a fun capstone.
Thank you, team.